And I'm very happy to open this session with Julian López Gómez from Complutense University of Madrid. He's going to give his talk on the blackboard, and the title of the talk is Nodal Solution for a class of the Degenerate BVPs.
Grazie mille Alberto. Prima di tutto vorrei ringraziare gli organizzatori per il suo gentile invito per fare questa presentazione. Bianche non abbiamo potuto raggiungere a Roma il mio cuore con tutti voi attraverso le onde. Now I think we can start with the mathematics. And the mathematics I'm going to analyze today is a very simple problem. It's a one-dimensional boundary value problem, also linear time, minus second derivative of u equal to lambda u, minus a of x u to the cube, is an interval 0 L, subject to the boundary conditions of the boundary, so u of 0 is equal to u of L is equal to 0, where the lambda is going to be viewed as a parameter, is going to be positive, and the A is going to be a continuous function in the interval 0 L in such a way that it is non-negative, different from 0. And well, look at the non-linearity, I have choose f of u equal to u to the cube, just because of simplicity for this position, and just because with this old non-linearity, whenever lambda u is a solution, automatically you have that lambda minus u is also a solution. So the solutions appear by pairs in this equation, and it's easier to make pictures of global bifurcation diagrams. So the main goal of the talk is to discuss the structure, the global structure of the set of non-trivial solutions of this problem, non-trivial solutions and solutions lambda u with u different from zero. Those solutions have a very important property, is that whenever you have an interior zero, a zero in the interval zero L, it could be the boundary for the u, the zeros are going to be denoted sometimes by nodes. So for me, zero and nodes are synonym, they are the same. So whenever you have a zero, automatically, if the u does not vanish identically, u prime in Z is said that is different from zero. It cannot be equal to zero, because otherwise, by uniqueness of the solutions for the problem associated to the second order equation, the u would be automatically zero. So any zero must be isolated. So all zeros are isolated. And this means that whenever you take the set of zeros in the interval zero, the set of zeros is necessarily finite. Okay? Then solutions are going to be of the following type, are going to be positive solutions in zero n or negative, the opposite, so are going to be solutions with one interior zero. No, it's this type of solutions with u prime of zero positive derivative in zero positive or negative. Okay, the opposite. They are going to have two interior nodes. They are going to have three interior nodes and so on. Okay, it's a nodal solution, zero nodes. I'm going to take into account mainly the interior nodes. This is a one node solution. This is a two node solution. And I want to study the global structure of the set of solutions of this problem. And there are two different situations. One is the classical case when the coefficient a of x, the function coefficient a of x is positive for any x in the interval 0, L. So a of x is going to have a graph of this type, is going to be something separated away from 0. The graph, and there is the degenerated case. This is the degenerate case. The degenerate case is the case when the ray vanishes in some interval, compact interval within the interval zero. So this is a compact interval with alpha less than beta in zero A. So the A in the degenerate case is going to have a profile, a graph of this type. So goes down as zero in alpha, it vanishes in alpha beta, and then it's positive from beta to tour. And these are the two cases I'm going to deal with. So the first case I'm going to consider is the classical case, and there is one classical case which is particularly simple, is when the A is the constant one, because in that case it's autonomous, the equation, and we can use Phase-Port stress techniques to do all the analysis. So I'm going to stop some minutes to remember you the classical results. Later I will give you the last advances. I will not have enough time to do proofs, obviously, because in half an hour it is impossible. So in the case when A is equal to one, if you differentiate the derivative, you call B to the derivative, you multiply the equation by the U prime and you rearrange the terms, you are going to get that B squared over two plus lambda half U squared minus U to the four divided by four prime is equal to zero. And this means that whenever the solution is defined, B squared of x divided by 2 plus lambda half u squared of x minus u4 of x divided by 4. This is going to be some constant for all x, maximum interval of definition of the solution of the equation. So this has the plane fixes of the total energy of the system. The system is conservative, so the kinetic energy is going to be V squared over 2, and the potential energy going to depend on the position. This is going to be denoted by phi of u is the function lambda half u squared minus u to the 4 divided by 4. And this is a conservation law. It says to you that the total energy at u of x, v of x is constant for all x in the maximum interval of definition of the solution. And this property mathematically is crucial because it allows you to know the speed in any point of the movement as soon as we know the position, because we can eliminate from here the v in terms of the u. So the v of x is going to be plus minus the root square of 2, the total energy minus the potential energy in v of x. Okay, so this means that if whenever the solution is defined and the solution satisfies this equation, the integral curve, the solution must be in the integral curves in the set of values of u and v in the plane, where the v is equal to plus minus root square of 2 times the total energy minus the phi of u. So all what we have to do is to represent all these curves, and this is a simple exercise, okay, to be able to construct the dynamic of the system. And the dynamic is the following one. The potential energy in this case is a function, either function which has a minimum and two maxima with the same altitude at the equilibria of the equation root square of lambda minus root square of lambda and zero. So when you go to the phase plane, you represent here and you represent u and v. Then you have this equilibrium here. This is a saddle point. This is a minimum, therefore it's stable, it's a center. And here you have another maximum, so it is a saddle point. And if you take this level of total energy, then you have that the curve, the integral curve is something like this one. By the symmetry of the problem, you have B equal to plus minus root square. Therefore, you have all these integral curves, which consists of finitely many trajectories. In this case, you have this trajectory, this heteroclinic trajectory joining these two equilibria, this other trajectory, this other trajectory, this other trajectory, this other. So in total, 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay, now I pair it. So 2, 4, 6, 8. Okay. And then you vary the level of energy, you are going to get other kind of trajectories. Interactors, this is trajectory of any solution starting on it. And if you take something smaller, then you are going to get this kind of trajectories here. And then you are going to get this periodic orbit. This corresponds with the anorbic aperiodic orbit. And then you have this elliptic trajectory here. You have the hit the tipping cut arc. This is the cut arc. And we are looking for positive solutions of the problem. So I'm going to focus attention. I'm going to use a shooting argument here. So I'm going to fix some point here, and I'm going to shoot in this point. So this means that I take the solution such that of the second order equation such that in zero is zero, and the derivative in zero is V0. You have here an equilibrium root square of lambda, you see. If the speed is greater than the critical speed of the heteroclinic, if it is the critical speed of the heteroclinic, this one automatically the solution goes as time goes to infinity to root square of lambda. So this is the profile of the solution. This is u of x versus x. But if the speed is bigger, then the solution is going to cross the equilibrium root square of lambda. So the solution is going to be this one. And actually it blows up in a final time there. But then if the solution is smaller, the speed is smaller than the critical speed of the heteroclinic, then you are going to get a periodic solution. Okay, so the solution after some time is going to reach its maximum separation with respect to the equilibrium at U0. Okay, and then it's going to go down in the same time by the symmetries of the problem. The time needed to run this is fourth part of the period. So this is the same time as it need to go from here to here. And then the other part is running the same time. So the solution is going to be of this type. It's something periodic. And it needs a time, T of U0, to reach, or T of V0 if you want, to reach the maximum separation U0 with respect to the equilibrium position. And this time you can compute, these are the unique solutions that can provide us with nodal solutions of the problem, because the other solutions are not going to back again to have another zero. And we need solutions with at least two zeros in zero and in L. So the time of U0 is going to be equal to the integral between zero and time of U0 of U prime of X divided by B. This is a tautology because U prime has been defined as B. It doesn't define as your prime. Then you substitute the V by value. And then you have here your prime of X divided by root square of 2, the total energy minus pi of U of X. Yes. And if you make a central variable here, U of X equal to psi. And later you do psi equal to U0 theta. Then you are going to get that this is equal to the integral between 0 and 1 of d theta divided by the root square of lambda 1 minus theta square minus u square, U0 square divided by 2, 1 minus theta to the 4. This is the necessary time to reach the maximum separation with respect to the equilibrium position. So to run along this arc of the orbit of this periodic solution. So this is fourth part of the period of this solution. So we need to find a value of U0 in such a way that the time necessary to, if we want to construct a positive solution, we need to construct, to show that we have a U0 for which the time necessary to reach the maximum separation with respect to the equilibrium is half, in such a way that it goes down to zero. In it. And this is going to provide us with a positive solution. So we need the values of U0 for which T U0 is equal to L half. This is what we need to solve. So have a look at the T. The T is an increasing function in U0. This decreases, but you have the minus. So here with the minus decreases, and it is in the denominator, so it is increasing. In zero, the value you keep this term here is 1 over root square of lambda. And the integral between 0 and 1 or 1 over root square of 1 minus theta square, the primitive is an cosine. So it is by half, okay? And as the U0 goes to the equilibrium root square of lambda, the trajectory approaches to the heteroclinic connection, but the heteroclinic equilibrium cannot be reached in a final time, it's reaching infinity time, and therefore time of not must go to infinity. So the graph of the T, of the period the time mark is the following one. It has the following graph. This is the minimum value. This is 1 over root square of lambda pi half. It grows and it goes to infinity root square of lambda. Okay, this is the graph. Then we have some u naught such that t u naught is equal to l half if and only if the l half is above t naught, which is 1 over the square of lambda pi half. But this is equivalent to say that the lambda is greater than pi over l squared. You can eliminate from here, it is equivalent. So whenever the lambda is greater than pi over l squared, we have a unique positive solution because there is a unique value of u naught for which we have a positive solution, not the unique negative solutions are the opposites. Now, one observation, if you increase the lambda, the t map decreases, so the u naught increases, so the branch is increasing. When the L half goes to this value here, equivalently, when the lambda goes to pi over L squared, the U node goes to the left and goes to zero. So it bifurcates from zero. Okay, I'm putting here the parameter lambda and I'm representing in ordinates the value of U node of lambda. So you get an increasing curve, lambda parameter by lambda, U node of lambda, which take into account, which represent all the positive solutions of the problem. So whenever you have a positive subpoint in this curve, we are talking about some solution which grows with a lambda, some positive solution. And here you have the negative solution. These are the opposites of the other ones. Okay, so we have constructed all the positive solutions and now we want to construct all solutions, so nodal solutions. So solutions with one interior node, by the symmetry of the problem, the interior node must be in L half. So I'm going to identify it with positive solutions in the interval L zero L half. So these are going to be positive solutions in zero L half. The solutions with two interior nodes, with the nodes by the symmetry of the problem must be placed at L third to L third, are going to be identified with positive solutions, in the interval zero L third, and so on. So these solutions bifurcate from pi over L over two, so from two pi over L squared, okay? And they are smaller than the others because the positive solution in the whole interval is a super solution in the problem is about this one. When we did the shooting argument, the solutions in the interval zero L are these solutions, the solutions in the interval zero L half are these solutions, the solution in the interval zero L third are these solutions, so they are smaller and smaller, okay? So these solutions, they are ordered. These represent the solutions which have an interior node. These represent the solutions with an interior node and negative derivative in zero. They bifurcate from two pi over L squared. The positive solution by bifurcate from zero at a pi over L squared. Then we have three pi over L squared and the solution with two interior nodes by bifurcating from here and so on and so forth. So for lambda in between these two points, you have three solutions, two non-trivial solutions. For lambda in between these two values, you have four non-trivial solutions, six and so on. You can construct a whole set of solutions and you have a lot of information now. What's going on? This is very simple because it is autonomous. What's going on in the general case when the function a of x is continuous? Then this kind of tennis, if it is a general continuous function, cannot be used. They are not going to work. And then it was Rabinovich in the early 70s who developed theory to attack that problem. So Rabinovich did the following using local bifurcations, the theorem with Crandall. He showed it The system of some local curves bifurcating from any from the trivial solution at any of these values. This is an application of the implicit function theorem. Okay, and then he considered all the components bifurcating from the trivial solution in any of those values. So the component bifurcating from pi over L squared is going to be C1. The component bifurcating from 2 pi over L squared is going to be C2. This is going to be C3. And in general, the component bifurcating lambda n equal to n pi over L squared is going to be denoted by Cn. This is a component consisting of solutions with n minus one interior nodes. Using topological degree, he was able to see that the component bifurcating from these points is unbounded. Cn is unbounded in L sometimes continuous in zero. Okay, we can see that there are no solutions on the left. This is very easy because if you rewrite the differential equation in the following way, this is equal to lambda u minus a of x, you can write down it, express it as minus second derivative plus a u squared acting on u equal to lambda u. So if the u is a solution with n minus one interior nodes, then the lambda must be the nth eigenvalue of the operator minus second derivative plus a u squared. And since these eigenvalues are monotonic with respect to the potential, this is going to be greater than the nth eigenvalue of the minus second derivative in the interval 0, but this is equal to n pi over L squared. Therefore, no solutions with n minus one nodes are on the left, can be on the left of n pi over L squared. So they must be on the right. But on the other side, the positive solutions provide us with bounds for any nodal solution. Because the nodal solutions, you have a positive solution. The positive solution is going to be always a super solution of the problem in a smaller interval. So any nodal solution must lie by the maximum principle in between the positive solution and the negative solution. So all the nodal solutions must be in between the positive solution and the negative solution. Must be in between them. So you have a priori bounds as soon as you get a priori bounds for the positive solution. But since the problem is classical, A of x is positive everywhere, large positive constants provide us with super solutions very easily for the positive solution. So the bifurcation diagram, the global bifurcation diagram, looks like really like this. For the positive solutions, for C1, of course, one can prove using the implicit function theorem that the set of positive and negative solutions conform an analytic curve, okay? And that you only have, for any value of lambda, delta, and this value of the parameter, only have one positive and one negative solutions. But for the nodal solutions, almost nothing is known, even in the classical case when the A of X is positive everywhere. And this is one of the problems I want to analyze now. So now I want to present to the, so classically the CN is a component. So this means that it is a cross connected, it's a continuum, it is a cross connected set, which is maximal for the inclusion. So it is a connected component of the set of non-trivial solutions emanating from the trivial solution from at n pi over n squared, okay? This is all the topological information that it is known for CN, for n greater or equal than b, up to the results I want to discuss and to present you now. So now I'm going to present you a very recent result that I have found with one of my students in San Pedro, Juan Carlos San Pedro, that was sent to Madrid by Luis Vega in Bilbao, because Luis Vega showed him what he was working about, but he didn't like it because he was to apply. And then Luis Vega told him, go to Madrid with Julian. This is a recent result. We could prove that in this case, because the nonlinearity is analytic, the set of solutions consists of a discrete set of parts of analytic curve. Of analytic curve. Those are the split set of bifurcation those branching points. For all n, this is for n equal to 1 equal 1, but this is completely new for the general case. Now it's a very shallow result because there is a little reason, some little research examples. When Tolan saw my paper a couple of weeks ago, he sent me a paper that I didn't have enough time to look at it, but he gave examples with same infinity for which Cn does not need to be connected by us. So the analyticity is something really fantastic because it allows you to apply the global, allows you to apply a theory from algebraic geometry, the global from analytic geometry to be able to solve this problem. Concretely, the fundamental theorem, of analytic geometry. Now I want to present some, once we know this about the structure of the solution set in the general case, I would like to present you some bifurcation diagrams in the classical case when f x still is positive for all x in 0 n, the classical case, which is part of some work that we are doing with Pablo Escudillo, another student of mine, who is doing mainly numerics in this kind of problems together with Andrea Perini and myself. This is also very recent. And I'm going to show you a series of weight functions. For instance, this weight function, which is has two weights, but it is positive. Okay, symmetric with respect to zero, with respect to the L half. This is L. Okay, this is zero. And then you have a bifurcation diagram for C1 of the following type. Okay, bifurcation from 2 pi over L squared. It goes this way. And then here there is a branching point of a branch. Okay, and then you have the solutions, the opposite solutions with u prime of zero negative. And then you have the bifurcation diagram. So you have up to six nodal solutions. So the uniqueness of the positive solution for the nodal solutions is definitely is not true. Even in the classical case, this is an example with six solutions. Okay, this solution has the zero in this interval. The central solution has the symmetric, has the zero in your half. The other solution has the zero here in this other interval. And in total, you have six. These solutions are with u prime of zero positive, these solutions with u prime of zero negative. Some more examples. Some more examples. For instance, if you take three wells, symmetry, then you get something of the following type. And you have here one component, another component. So in total, we are going to have 5, 2, 4, and 1, 5. So apart from C1, okay, this is C1, there are another four components. So the structure can be pretty, very complex when the coefficients are especially heterogeneous, like in this case. So here, moreover, we have some loop bifurcating from the primary branch. Okay, but my theory with San Pedro, this is everything is analytic here. The structure, this is a one, and here you have another four components. So in total, here you have 5 and 5, 10 non-trivial solutions. Okay, in general, when you have k wells, you can construct examples with 4k, minus two solutions. So we have examples with as many other solutions as you wish, with only one node. There is more complexity if we increase the number of nodes. Okay. So now this is all what I know at present, more or less about the classical problem. I want to pass to the degenerate problem where the things are completely different or are slightly different. And the degenerate problem is a problem that I have analyzed mainly with Paul Rabinowitz during the 5, 6, 7 years. So now I'm going to assume that n minus 1 of 0 is alpha beta, in such an interval of 0n. And so it's a wave function like this one. And there is a classical result. Well, I told you before that if we have a normal solution, then lambda is the eigen value of it's a Rodinger operator. There is monotonicity with respect to the domain, so this is less than the eigen value of this operator plus a u squared in alpha beta, but in alpha beta a is equal to zero, so this eigenvalue is a pi divided by beta minus alpha squared. While the same as before, this is greater than n pi divided by n squared. So lambda must be in a bounded interval between these values. This is a huge difference with respect to the classical case, because the set of values for which we are going to have another solution is bounded. Now, it was in 1996 that together with Freiling, was student of Herbert Amann Merino, student of Herbert Opita Hess, and myself, we prove that there is a positive solution. There is a positive solution if and only if, lambda lies in the interval between pi over L squared and 2 pi over pi over beta minus alpha squared. Well, there were some previous results by Brzezinski Oswald and also by Ojan, the student of Wemini, his doctoral thesis, that it has a mistake in some part of the proof, where they, using variational methods of global continuation, they were able to characterize the system of positive solutions in this case. This was the first paper we gave a very general result, where that in this case it gives you this result valid for any arbitrary boundary conditions and arbitrary second order elliptic operators. This is a theorem, moreover, the solution is unique. And then, I think I almost finished my time. It was in 2015-17 before Rabinowitz. Myself, but we were able to prove that there is a solution with two minus one nodes. If and only if the lambda lies in between n pi over n squared and n pi over beta minus alpha squared. But now, moreover, we got a unique inner result. Moreover, the solution is unique. If you lie, the lambda lies between n minus 1 pi divided by beta minus alpha squared and n pi divided by beta minus alpha squared. This is the interval of uniqueness. It is the unique result that I know, general result that I know in the context for nodal solutions. This is a very sharp problem because actually, when lambda is smaller than this one, we know how to construct a sample with as many solutions as we wish. So this is really sharp. The theorem, the uniqueness. So now I want to finish my talk and making a picture of some possible situation, admissible situation, dealing with the solutions with one node in a non-degenerate problem, so that you can see the difficulty that we have in this theory. The main novel. So when beta minus alpha is less than a half, then we have here, you have here pi over L squared. It's the point where the positive solution by 4k, 2 pi over L squared, the point where the solutions with one node by 4k, pi over beta minus alpha squared. This is the point where the positive solutions go to infinity in alpha beta. They go to a meta solution there, okay? And then you have here the point 2 pi over beta minus alpha squared, where the solutions with that now node should be. Is this interval, the interval of lambda, where we have solutions with one node? But the positive solution provides that with a priori bounds. This is C1 for C2. So this is C2. And the first time that we realized that this component could be unbounded in this point It was through a numerical sample that it was computed by Marina Medie, in a joint paper with Rabinovich. Okay, and then we realized that they were the samples with two components, at least with three components. Apart from C2, we have D2 plus and D2 minus. Okay, so the component of the classical theory is not enough to describe the set of nodal solutions. We need something more, something else. Okay, this is what makes the theory very complicated. Because in the classical theory, the positive solution provides us with a priori bound, but we do not have now, in this case, we don't have positive solution for all the interval of lambdas where we have the nodal solutions. And this is why this theory is much more complicated than the other. Okay, so after a couple of years, 3 years, last year, it appeared in the GDR paper by Rabinovich and myself, where we were able to construct explicit examples of continuous wave functions for which we have this situation here, where we were able to prove the existence of at least two components, okay? And examples where we were able to see that C2 is bounded in this critical value in pi over beta minus alpha squared and can be continued, it can be prolongated up to this value here where it bifurcates to infinity. And I think I'm going to stop. I should stop here. Thank you very much for your attention.